Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Is This Wi-Fi Organic? A Guide to Spotting Misleading Science Online by Dave Farina. Narrated by Dave Farina. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to images present in the print and ebook formats of the book. This applies in particular to Chapter 1. For my father, Vittorio, and my son, Reza, may the thirst for knowledge perpetuate. Introduction. How does the public perceive science? Let's play a game of word association. Science. Let this word simmer in your mind for a moment. Examine every texture. Taste the nuance. What does this word make you think of? How does it make you feel? Do you imagine futuristic cityscapes? Do you feel hopeful? Do you picture billowing smokestacks? Do you feel terrified? Does it remind you of school? Does that hold a positive or negative connotation for you? As to what you envisioned, it may have been any of these or something totally different still. But the general consensus of the American public on this matter can be quite easily traced through recent history. In the years following World War II, the American economy was booming. The middle class was gainfully employed, adequately fed and sheltered, and filled with optimism. Because of this, science was viewed as a gleaming obelisk of limitless advancement. It was Disneyland's Tomorrowland. It was the Jetsons. It was longevity and prosperity. But over the decades that followed, this attitude changed. Administrations came and went. Post-war prosperity slowly dwindled, giving way to capitalism as we know it today, a poorly regulated industrial playground, absorbing wealth from the citizenry like a sponge. On this front, a resurgence of economic inequality suppressed what had briefly been a growing middle class. On another front, evidence of sustained environmental damage began to surface. Once these technology-enabled disasters came to outweigh the sheer excitement of the moon landing, that shiny obelisk was replaced with a barrel of toxic green goo. This trend in corporate practice is not exclusive to American corporations, nor is the resulting anti-establishment sentiment exclusive to the American public. These issues span the globe, infiltrating every nook and cranny of our civilization. It is not surprising that there is widespread distrust of large corporations today. They are to blame for so much pollution and injury, and betrayal runs deep. But far too often, this distrust of industry is misplaced onto science itself. It is not just big business that is greeted with skepticism. The foundation of knowledge that commerce has built itself upon is also in question. We must make every effort possible to keep these two distinct entities separate. In one realm sits the undeniably valid scientific principles upon which technological progress rests, an ostensibly neutral body of knowledge. A separate realm contains all of the people and institutions that produce said progress and the accompanying large-scale social change, for better or for worse. The latter camp must be judged for its actions on a case-by-case basis, without sullying the reliability of scientific knowledge, because while people have motives, information does not. In other words, although science denial is sometimes rooted in justifiable sentiment, it is not rooted in logic, and therefore simply is not the answer to our problems. The dangers of rejecting our fundamental knowledge of nature are compounded in the information age, whose crowning achievement is the almighty internet. Although this invention has only been in widespread use for a mere 2 decades, it is already utterly and inextricably embedded in the functionality of our civilization. The internet is how we do things, and it is how we know things. It is how we communicate with one another. It is how we know which movies are playing this weekend, where to find the best Italian restaurant, or what the weather is like before looking out the window. Beyond trivialities, however, the internet is also the way many people probe the nature of reality to amass a worldview. continuing the trend set into motion by the printing press nearly six centuries ago. The internet represents the ultimate democratization of information. There we find all of the information, updated in real time, essentially for free, apart from costly primary scientific literature. Anyone can access this mountain of data, and anyone can throw whatever they please onto the pile. While there are tremendous benefits to this paradigm shift, as it has become increasingly difficult to censor information, the transparency comes at a price. We have condemned ourselves to perpetually sifting through a digital cacophony of contradiction that often leaves truth obscured. Prior to the internet, there were sources of information that were unanimously agreed upon to be trustworthy and reliable. Stories published by newspapers had to be heavily researched by professional journalists. Knowledge from an encyclopedia was not questioned by those who needed to reference a fact, because they were written by top specialists in every discipline, which contributed to their considerable cost. Whether we regard them as good or bad, those times are gone, and they are never coming back. Unlike the encyclopedias of old, the quality of information on the internet is not reliable. It ranges from outstanding to abysmal. For this reason, the internet can serve as a magic mirror, a place where people go to confirm pre-existing bias. Outlets that reflect what we already know are correct and trustworthy. Those that do not are ignored, deemed fraudulent, deceitful, paid for by malevolent institutions, or worse. This method of assessment rarely has any respect for the qualifications of those who produce the content we encounter, which has led to what is popularly referred to as the post-truth era. In this relatively new era, irrefutable facts and the firm consensus of the scientific community are often eschewed in favor of charlatans who peddle nothing more than a flashy narrative. Such pseudoscientific narratives have become popular for a number of reasons. On a more subtle and philosophical level, we are susceptible to wishful thinking. Science offers us a cold and indifferent universe, a narrative that is antithetical to the divinely ordained status humanity has grown accustomed to over the millennia. But the appeal to pseudoscience also arrives largely in response to harmful practices enacted by the aforementioned large corporations. And because anti-corporate sentiment is so widely held, it has become trivial to fool large sectors of the population with a handful of buzzwords and scare tactics. There was a time when charlatans would travel from town to town selling snake oil. This useless concoction was peddled as a cure-all for what ails you, and gullible people would buy it. Since that time, snake oil has become a euphemism for deceptive marketing, and the sale of digital snake oil is rampant on the internet. This new and improved incarnation is not limited to potions and lotions. It has morphed into an idea, a feeling, a way of believing the universe must operate. It has always been clear that if a number of people are willing to buy a particular product, someone will create that product in order to profit off of the demand. But beyond this, it is now clear that if enough people simply want to believe in a particular reality, media will be crafted to corroborate that reality. The desire to believe becomes the tendency to click, and clicks mean bucks. This is no secret. Information exists on the internet because it is to be clicked upon, and not because it necessarily correlates with reality. Therefore, finding what you want to believe on the internet doesn't immediately make it true, no matter how true it feels. This aspect of the post-truth era is a huge problem. Because almost every opinion imaginable exists on the internet, whether it is based in fact or not, even highly intelligent users can regularly find themselves incapacitated. This product that I'm interested in purchasing, is it safe to use? One source says no, another says yes, others something in between. Is this corporation behaving ethically? One source says no, another says yes, and many more are somewhere in the middle. What do I want? What should I do? Who should I be? Again, a bevy of bumf. This peril is compounded by the fact that misinformation is shared on a daily basis, such that it spreads like a virus across countless social media platforms, rapidly gaining momentum in a way that was impossible prior to the existence of the internet. So where does that leave us? If every worldview imaginable is supported in one place or another, how can we sort fact from falsehood? Is there some reliable algorithm for sniffing out all the lies and propaganda, or are we doomed to exist in epistemological limbo for the remainder of human civilization? Well, there is a way, but it involves learning. To some, the prospect of learning something new is invigorating. To most, who are exhausted after a long day of work, learning something new is a chore and a nuisance. But there really is no other way. If you want to know whether some product is safe to use, it will not suffice to simply read yes or no on the internet, as they are both there for you to find. You must be equipped to comprehend the explanations that are given. Some of them will correlate with the nature of reality, and others will not. In many cases, this is shockingly trivial to discern. To be scientifically literate, you don't have to be an expert in anything. You don't have to know all of the science. In fact, no one does, not by a long shot. The era of polymaths like Benjamin Franklin and Leonardo da Vinci is long gone. There is far too much science for anyone, even scientists, to know any more than a tiny sliver of the pie. It would seem that the Renaissance men of Da Vinci's caliber were truly only possible in the Renaissance, prior to the landslide of progress that was the 20th century. Today we are left with a behemoth for a body of scientific knowledge, but the immensity of this beast should not discourage anyone from examining it. It is far too common that individuals label themselves as non-science people, concluding that it's all just above their intellect. But the average citizen doesn't need to understand quantum mechanics. We don't even have to do any math. We simply need a conversational level of proficiency in the most rudimentary concepts from the major areas of scientific inquiry. In this book, there are tools. Basic information will be offered regarding a few fundamental fields, those being chemistry, biochemistry, biology, and physics. This knowledge will then be used to deconstruct popular narratives found in various media. We will look at claims that are made out there in the ether and evaluate them. Do they hold up to scrutiny? If not, then precisely how much do we need to know in order to recognize such false information? Again, you may be surprised at just how little knowledge is required in order to read something and instantly reject it, as those who peddle pseudoscience underestimate you. They arrogantly believe that they can fabricate narratives which are completely inconsistent with what we as a species know to be true about the universe, and the vast majority of readers will never be the wiser. Let's prove them wrong. Chapter 1. What are all these lines and hexagons? Take a look at this image. Don't panic. That's a molecule. As it happens, this molecule is called folic acid, also known as vitamin B9, which is an essential component of most living things. It may just look like some lines, shapes, and letters, but that's the way this particular molecule is visually represented. Molecules are collections of atoms, and atoms make up pretty much everything you see and touch on Earth. If we want to be able to talk about what goes on inside the human body, what drugs are and what they do, and how all of this intersects with industry, this is where we have to start. If we wish to separate myth from reality, we have to be fundamentally equipped to understand why organic does not mean pure, natural does not mean good, synthetic does not mean bad, and all of the other common misconceptions that make us vulnerable to false advertising. In order to later dig into all of this juicy stuff, which is the primary purpose of this book, we first have to be able to look at a structure like this and know what it represents. That means we are going to have to learn a few things about chemistry. I can sense you recoiling already. What did you get yourself into? Is this a concise and leisurely airplane read, or is this homework? Fret not. We are simply going to breeze through the bare minimum background information as fast as humanly possible. Skip ahead if you don't believe me. In less time than it would take to cook a frozen pizza, you will be able to comprehend this image, so let's get started. An introduction to chemistry must begin with atoms. Atoms, though incredibly tiny, are made of three smaller things still. Those are protons and neutrons, which are of similar size and mass, sitting in the central nucleus, and electrons, which are even tinier, existing far away from the nucleus. Protons have a positive electric charge. Electrons have a negative electric charge, while neutrons are neutral, bearing no electric charge. Oppositely charged particles attract one another, and like charges repel. The protons and electrons, through this influence upon one another via the electromagnetic force, are responsible for the entirety of chemistry. Meanwhile, neutrons do not serve this function. Instead, they help hold the atomic nucleus together via a different force called the strong nuclear force. This force is much stronger than the electromagnetic repulsion pushing the protons apart, and is thus the reason atomic nuclei are stable, with the protons and neutrons fused together like a bunch of grapes. So that's where we begin, with protons, neutrons, electrons, and the atoms they form by their various combinations. We could talk about even smaller particles still, or we could talk about precisely why opposite charges attract. But it's all too complicated and doesn't serve our main purpose, so just take these facts for granted and we will build from here. Now, different atoms can contain different numbers of these particles. Take the proton. An atom might have one proton in its nucleus. It might have two, or three, all the way up to over 100. It will also have some neutrons, which for smaller atoms will be the same or almost the same as the number of protons, and for larger atoms, closer to 1.5 times the number of protons. But it is specifically the number of protons that determines which element the atom belongs to, which essentially means the type of atom, and every element has a corresponding set of chemical properties. An atom with one proton is called hydrogen, represented by the symbol H. An atom with two protons is called helium, represented by the symbol He. Each time we add a proton, we get the next element on the ever-familiar periodic table, each with its own characteristic symbol of either one or two letters, displayed below an atomic number that refers to the number of protons in the nucleus. Adding to this, a neutral atom has precisely as many electrons as it does protons. These electrons move at astonishing speeds within little regions of space called orbitals that project away from the nucleus. If we think of an atom as an apartment complex, then an orbital is like one of the apartments where electrons can stay, up to two of them per unit. These orbitals have different shapes which require knowledge of quantum mechanics to understand, so we won't get into that here. We simply must know that electrons are the particles that allow chemistry to occur. TLDR, a chemical element, is a particular type of atom, defined by the number of protons in its nucleus. Next, we must understand that atoms can bond with one another, like two fingers in a Chinese finger trap. And when these bonds break and form, that's chemistry in action. Chemical reactions are processes in which atoms rearrange their combinations with one another. Visualizing atoms now as spheres of different colors, refer to this example where methane, CH4, reacts in the presence of oxygen, O2, to produce carbon dioxide, CO2, and water, H2O. Each of these substances is a molecule, which contains atoms of one or more elements participating in chemical bonds with one another. When we write these, each number in subscript refers to the number of atoms present of the element listed immediately to its left. So methane contains one carbon atom and four hydrogen atoms. Coefficients to the left of a substance indicate the number of molecules of that substance involved in the reaction, such as the two water molecules produced. In the course of any chemical reaction, atoms rearrange their configurations to produce new substances, and in doing so, they conserve their number, so no atoms are created or destroyed. But what is a chemical bond? Well, as previously mentioned, electrons and protons come together to form atoms because of the electromagnetic attraction between them, due to their opposing charges. Beyond this, protons from the nucleus of one atom can also attract electrons from another atom. If two atoms each share one electron with the other, such that the two shared electrons sit between them, feeling the pull of each nucleus, this constitutes a covalent bond, which we typically represent in shorthand as simply a line between two atoms. Two atoms can also share two pairs of electrons to make two bonds, which we would represent with two lines, and refer to as a double bond. They can even share three pairs of electrons to make three bonds, which we call a triple bond. The greater the number of shared electrons, the stronger the bond. And finally, atoms can possess pairs of electrons that do not form a bond, but rather belong exclusively to one atom, which we would call a lone pair of electrons. TLDR, atoms share electrons to form covalent bonds. Once again, these types of chemical bonds we are discussing are called covalent bonds, which refers to bonds in which electrons are shared between two atoms. There are other types of bonds as well, which will be discussed a bit later. But for now, certain elements that are primarily found in the upper right section of the periodic table, which are called nonmetals, are very good at making covalent bonds with one another. These include hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and sulfur, which also happen to be the six elements most commonly found in living organisms. Atoms of these elements come together in different combinations to form countless different molecules, both familiar and unfamiliar. So let's now get a better understanding of the properties of molecules. Looking first at small molecules, like the ones in the combustion reaction we mentioned earlier, these take on specific geometries. Consider some central atom with multiple atoms or sets of atoms attached to it, which we can call groups. These groups will spread out in space so as to be as far away from each other as possible, because the negatively charged electrons surrounding those atoms repel one another. Recall that while particles of opposite charge experience an attraction, particles of like charge experience a repulsion. So imagine like poles of tiny bar magnets pushing themselves apart. If there are two groups surrounding a central atom, we get a line, as they can get no farther away from each other than being on opposite sides of the central atom. If there are three, we get a triangle, which again maximizes these bond angles. If there are four, we begin to utilize the third spatial dimension, and we get a tetrahedral arrangement. It is the repulsion between these groups that is pushing them as far away from each other as geometry will physically allow. To be clear, a group in this context can be either an atom or a lone pair of electrons, as these will produce repulsion in a similar manner. This is the reason that molecules like carbon dioxide and water have different shapes, despite each containing three atoms. With carbon dioxide, the carbon atom is surrounded by two groups, those being the two oxygen atoms, and will thus be a linear molecule. Water involves an oxygen atom surrounded by two hydrogen atoms and two lone pairs of electrons, which equals four groups. This results in a tetrahedral arrangement and a bent shape for the molecule. TLDR, molecules take on specific shapes that allow groups to spread out as much as geometrically possible. Now let's allow these molecules to get a little bigger. Molecules will commonly contain primarily carbon and hydrogen, so let's go ahead and construct a molecule with just those elements, which we would call a hydrocarbon. Hydrogen has only one electron, so it can make only one bond, in this case by sharing it with a carbon atom. Carbon has four so-called valence electrons, which means the outermost ones that are available for bonding. So carbon can make up to four bonds. Here we can see that each carbon makes four bonds to four different atoms. This includes either one or two other carbon atoms, with the remaining bonds going to hydrogen atoms. Since each carbon makes four bonds, they exhibit the tetrahedral geometry we previously mentioned, and that's why we see this zigzag pattern. It's also why we have to use what are called dash bonds and wedge bonds, so as to display the molecular geometry accurately. The dashes mean that the bond projects away from the viewer, beyond the page, while the wedges mean that the bond projects toward the viewer, in front of the page. This makes it possible to represent three-dimensional molecules on a two-dimensional page or screen. And with that understood, we can observe the true geometry of a molecule like this. Now that we have a basic understanding of chemical bonding and molecular geometry, we can translate this structural representation into what we call line notation, which is the method by which that molecule at the beginning of the chapter was depicted. To do this, we need to know just two things. First, when writing molecules in line notation, every vertex and endpoint represents a carbon atom, since most large molecules are built from a carbon skeleton. And second, the hydrogen atoms in the molecule are implied, meaning they are not explicitly drawn. We simply have to know that they are there. So if we translate hexane into line notation, we are simply left with this zigzag line. Once again, every point is a carbon atom, and however many bonds are missing from each carbon, that's the number of hydrogen atoms that are assumed to be there. So the carbon on one end shows just one bond to the carbon atom next door, and that means three bonds to three separate hydrogen atoms are also there but not shown, since carbon tends to make four bonds. The carbons in the middle of the chain each show two bonds, one to each of the carbons on either side, and that means they each have two bonds to two separate hydrogen atoms that are not shown, again, to get to a total of four bonds. TLDR, with line notation, every vertex and endpoint is a carbon atom, and the hydrogen atoms are implied. Molecules aren't always linear. Sometimes they can be cyclic, with the carbon chain looping back around on itself. While this looks like a simple hexagon, we now understand that this is actually six carbon atoms, each of which is bonded to two hydrogen atoms. This symbol represents a molecule called cyclohexane, where the prefix cyclo indicates a cyclic molecule, and the prefix hex indicates six carbon atoms, while the suffix ane indicates that there is only one bond in between each of the carbon atoms. As we mentioned, atoms of certain elements, especially carbon, can make more than one bond between them. These are called double bonds and triple bonds. And in line notation, we continue to represent these with multiple lines. So taking cyclohexane and changing three of these single carbon-carbon bonds to double bonds, we get another molecule called benzene, which acts as the basis of many other molecules. Bear in mind that instead of two hydrogen atoms being implied on each carbon, there is only one, as each carbon is showing three bonds instead of two, leaving only one other bond available for bonding to hydrogen. With all of this understood, recall the image of folic acid that we described at the beginning of the chapter. Suddenly, things are a bit less cryptic. Every unlabeled vertex is a carbon atom, while atoms of other elements are represented by their chemical symbols. In this case, that means nitrogen, oxygen, and any hydrogen atoms which are bound to elements other than carbon. Every line is a bond, and two lines between two atoms means a double bond. Sometimes, to save space, we write common groups all at once. So OH means oxygen bonded to hydrogen, and we simply omit the line. The same goes for NH, where the line from N to H happens to be omitted as a shorthand. And most of the molecule is pretty flat, except for the one dash bond we see, which pushes that part of the molecule beyond the plane of the page. Now, that wasn't so bad, was it? Granted, we skipped a lot of information, and for the information we did cover, we went with the ultra-condensed version. but at the very least, we can now encounter molecules in line notation and know what we are looking at, even if we aren't yet familiar with what molecules do. Now let's take a brief moment to talk about that as well. As was stated earlier, molecules can undergo chemical reactions, whereby atoms rearrange their combinations. This will happen when two molecules collide with enough speed so as to react, and in a particular physical orientation. So, what is this orientation? Well, let's talk some more about electrons. Recall that the lines between the atoms are covalent bonds, whereby the two atoms are sharing two electrons. But these are not always shared evenly. One atom can be said to be more electronegative than the other, which means that it holds electrons more tightly, and thus the electron density in that bond will skew more closely toward the more electronegative atom, like they are playing tug of war with an electron rope and one atom is winning. This leaves one atom with some excess electron density and thus a partial negative charge, while the other atom is left with some electron deficiency and thus a partial positive charge. We call this a polar covalent bond, where polar refers to the polarization of the electron density, which rests closer to one atom than the other to some degree. When collisions occur which allow opposing partial charges on separate molecules to make contact, this is an example of a situation that is more likely to result in a chemical reaction. Once again, we know that opposite charges attract, and this is truly the driving force behind every chemical phenomenon. Chemical reactions occur when some electron excess meets some electron deficiency, when minusness meets plusness, so to speak. If a collision occurs such that these two regions can interact, new bonds replace old bonds, atoms rearrange, and we end up with different molecules than what we started with, provided that this new configuration is preferential to the original, according to a parameter called Gibbs free energy. The energy required to break the bonds is supplied by the collision itself, and then energy is released when the new bonds form. Chemistry has occurred. TLDR, chemical reactions occur when some electron excess, or minusness, meets some electron deficiency, or plusness. As is abundantly clear at this point, there is only one force that matters in chemistry, the electromagnetic force. It is the reason atoms exist, due to the attraction exhibited by subatomic particles of opposing charge. It is the reason those atoms come together through chemical bonds to form molecules. It is the reason molecules take on particular shapes, due to the repulsion of electrons with like charges. It is the reason electron density distributes itself around a molecule in a particular way. And it is the reason these atoms rearrange themselves into new combinations when molecules collide with sufficient energy and in the correct orientation, a phenomenon which we call a chemical reaction. Electron-rich meets electron-poor, a tale as old as time. And with that tale told, we know just enough about chemistry to move forward into other territory. Chapter 2: The Death of Vitalism. Imagine a time prior to the 19th century, a time when modern chemistry does not exist. Mankind has very little comprehension of the composition of matter. Atoms are merely an unsubstantiated philosophical concept, a relic from ancient Greek thinkers. Alchemy, the pseudoscientific practice of attempting to transform one element into another, is alive and well. In short, in this particular time, we have no clue what things are fundamentally made of. Because of this, a seemingly plausible belief called vitalism is widely held. This is the notion that the things which make up living organisms, all the bodily flesh and fluids, are somehow special and different from other matter. They possess some kind of intrinsic vitality that is absent in inanimate matter and beyond the capacity of mortal man to produce. These substances are bestowed with this vitality by God, and as man is not God, man is hopelessly unable to produce any substance which is of life. However, this notion was dispelled in the early 19th century through the work of a number of chemists of the era. One major achievement toward this end took place in 1828, when the German chemist Friedrich Wöhler accidentally synthesized the compound urea. This is a small molecule produced by mammals in order to excrete unused nitrogen atoms, which is done through urine. Chemists of the time were able to make this molecule in the laboratory from other non-vital substances, such as ammonium cyanate. What was especially surprising was that urea made in the lab was completely identical to natural urea in absolutely every respect. This result, which was not immediately comprehended at the time, demonstrates that there is no special property to the stuff of life that is beyond our mortal reach. The chemistry of life is the same as the chemistry of non-life. And with that, the field of organic chemistry was born. TLDR, there is no special vitality held by the molecules in living organisms that makes them fundamentally different from other molecules. Over the decades that followed, it became increasingly clear through the work of other chemists that there was no fundamental barrier to the synthesis of any particular molecule. And as their skills in the laboratory became more sophisticated, chemists developed increasingly clever strategies to synthesize molecules that were progressively more structurally complex, a practice which persists to this day. Our current prowess in the synthesis of molecules is astonishing. As an example, observe the structure of palytoxin, a compound found in certain types of coral, whose synthesis was achieved by Professor Yoshito Kishi at Harvard University in 1994. In fact, all of the major molecules of life, including sugars, proteins, nucleic acids, and vitamins, all of which will be discussed later, can easily be synthesized in the lab using strategies invented by chemists. When these molecules are inserted into a living system, they function precisely as those made by nature. There is absolutely no difference. However, as conclusive as this fact may be to the scientific community, it continues to elude large sectors of the public even two centuries after Wöhler initially uncovered it. Many people do not seem to fully understand or appreciate the fact that chemists can make molecules that exist in nature, and that they are absolutely identical in every way conceivable, because the properties of a molecule are completely defined by its structure and not at all by its origin. There is no vital force or vital energy that exists so as to be present in one version and not the other. The misunderstanding of this fundamental truth leads to a plethora of problems, which will be a persistent focus of chapters to come. But before we get there, we need to continue the thread we've just begun. It will not suffice for me to simply tell you that two molecules are the same. We have to understand precisely what chemists do and how they do it, in order for this conclusion to be blatantly obvious and self-evident. We need to know the mind of an organic chemist. What does an organic chemist do? What does organic mean in the first place? With respect to the masses, this is a buzzword that begs to be deconstructed for hours on end, and we will examine the word in that context a bit later. But in science, the word organic has a specific and straightforward meaning. An organic molecule is one that is carbon-based. Carbon has to be in there, whether it's one atom or a thousand. Hydrogen is almost always in there too, while oxygen and nitrogen are the next most common participants, followed by a small handful of other elements. To qualify as organic, a molecule need not be found in a living organism. It need not be made by natural processes. It doesn't even have to exist at all. It could be something conjured up in the mind of a chemist, never before encountered in the entire universe. If it's carbon-based, it's organic, and that's all there is to it. A synthetic organic chemist, which actually is not an oxymoron, is a person who synthesizes organic compounds. TLDR, in chemistry, Organic just means carbon-based and nothing else. So how does one do this? How does one make molecules? Does this involve the smallest tweezers imaginable and the delicate touch of a surgeon? Or one of those people that builds tiny ships and bottles? Nothing of the sort, actually. We can't see molecules. They are just too small. To give you an idea of how small they are, go and get a glass of water. Now stare at it. Imagine all those water molecules sloshing around, bumping into one another as they go. How many are in there? A million? A billion? Actually, it's closer to a trillion trillion. What does that even mean? Well, a trillion is a million millions. So imagine a million of something. Perhaps, why not apples? Picture them all together, arranged in a cube that is 100 apples long, 100 apples wide, and 100 apples.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.